Wi-Fi that will greatly assist people that are watching from home. Why don't we start the service with a prayer? God of our hope, we praise you. We put all of our faith in you, for where can we go but you? You have the words of life. Lord, open our ears this morning to hear you. Open our hearts to receive you again. Deal gently with us. Have mercy upon us. We're waiting for you. We're watching for you. We're listening for you. Fan the flame of our faith again, we pray, and fill us with a hope that does not disappoint, but brings us to peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now would you stand and greet one another, passing the peace of Christ.
Advent is here, and the first candle we light in the Advent wreath is a candle of hope. And we read from Psalm 25, which speaks of the hope that comes from trusting in God's loving and faithful ways.
To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. In you I trust, O my God. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one whose hope is in you will ever be put to shame, but they will be put to shame who are treacherous without excuse. Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. Remember, O Lord, your great mercy and love, for they are from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth and my rebellious ways. According to your love, remember me, for you are good, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in his ways. He guides the humble in what is right and teaches them his way. All the ways of the Lord are loving and faithful for those who keep the demands of his covenant. Let us pray. O God of the ages, you herald the coming of the Son of Man by wondrous signs in the heavens and on earth. Fill our hearts with hope so that we, in the company of the faithful, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, may be found ready to raise our heads at the coming of our redemption, the day of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Time to sing your song again, whatever may Would you pray with me? Lord, as we move from a season of thanksgiving to a season of Advent, we think of all the reasons, way more than 10,000 reasons, why we should be grateful and should seek you this season. We seek the mighty God in the most unlikely places, as a child in a stable and in an empty tomb. Lord, may you hear these prayers, which come from the unlikely corners of our lives. We lift up to you, Lord, those who we know and love, who are experiencing sickness today. We pray for your healing touch. We lift up those we know and love who are experiencing distress today. We pray for your calming presence. We lift up those who are experiencing addiction today. We pray for your healing touch. We lift up those who are grieving today, who experience loss. We pray for your comfort. We lift up those who are lonely and feel separated. We pray for your community and embrace for them. We lift up the homeless to you, Lord, and we pray that you would see the need and that you would mobilize us, your people, to respond. We specifically lift up the Ministry of Friendship House, this organization right here in Mount Vernon that provides essential services for those struggling with homelessness in our community. We pray that you would provide through them and for them, Lord, that your people would be generous in gifts of not just financial gifts, but in helping. We lift up the leaders of Friendship House. We lift up the volunteers. We lift up all those whose lives they touch. And we pray that the needle would be moved on homelessness through that ministry that we support. Give us ears to hear, O God, and eyes to watch, that we may know your presence in our midst during this holy season of joy, as we anticipate the coming of Jesus Christ, who, when he came the first time, taught his disciples to pray with these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As the ushers come forward to receive the offering this morning, hear these words from 2 Corinthians chapter 2. This service that you perform is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. And in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Amen.
Hey, good morning. Any children out there that would like to come up and join me over on these chairs for a message especially for you? Come on up if you want to. Wow, be careful of the violin, please. Let's not scare Bonnie. Well, welcome, guys. Good to have you. Oh, here we go. I hear the pitter-patter of little feet. There we go. All right, well, this morning, guys, I'm putting together a Christmas wish list. So if there's something you're wishing for Christmas, raise your hand and I'll write it on my list. So anyone have, oh, yeah. Jesus' blessing to come upon us again. You know what? That belongs on our hope list. I was going to talk about that next. That's such a good answer. I'm just going to move it right there to the Jesus hope list. Very cool. Good answer. Who else has got a wish for us? Yeah.
For everyone to have fun.
For everyone to have fun. Amen. That sounds like a good one. Do you have a wish? Trees. Her wish list is trees. Amen. I love that. Any other wishes out there? Yeah. No. Oh, snow. That makes more sense. I thought she said no. She said snow. Snow. Very good. All right. Well, today I want to talk about Christmas wishes and Christmas hopes because they're not exactly the same thing. A wish is something we really want. Like maybe on your Christmas wish, you would put a pony, okay? Like, mom and dad, I wish I had a pony. But your mom and dad might know that a pony is just not going to fit in your bedroom, right? And so they may not give you a pony, but maybe you'd get a stuffed pony, you know, something like that. But a wish is something we want. But hope is something different. And it gets to what you were talking about a moment ago. It's about the blessing of Jesus. It's about believing that God has given us so much in the past that God will give us more in the future. And we can participate. It's like your mom and your dad, right? Which of your moms and your dads gave you food this morning? Raise your hand if you got food this morning. Okay, cool. Food is good. No food? Okay, well, breakfast, most important meal of the day. Food, but your moms and your dads gave you food today, and so you have hope that they're going to give you food tomorrow. And what's more, you can help. You can help make the food. Or who moms and dads like to give their children a warm place to sleep. Who has a warm place to sleep? You know what? Your moms and dads do the best they can to give you that, and you have hope that you'll have a warm place to sleep. And you can help by keeping it clean, okay? That's the difference. God gives us so many good things, and we can help that hope become a reality. Yeah. Go ahead.
So, something for
the
wish list.
Oh, for the wish list. And Nadia wants to go to the wish list. Very good. Okay. Dog. I'll put it on the wish list. I don't know if the parents heard that one, but dog. It's right there. It's on the wish list. There you go. All right. Just so you know. All right. I like dogs too. Hey, there's a difference between wishing and hoping. Wishes sometimes don't come true. But the hope that we have in Jesus Christ does come true, and we can participate in it just a little in making all of God's good purposes come true in the world. That's what hope is. Let's pray. Lord God, give these kids the Christian hope that one day Jesus is going to redeem the world and all of our sufferings. In the meantime, help us to be a part of doing the right thing day by day to see your kingdom come alive in this world. Amen. Okay, guys, there's Club 3, 4, 5 for those who are ages, anyone? 3, 4, and 5, good answer. And the rest of you guys can go back to your seats. Well, good morning to all the children of God this morning. And today is the first Sunday of Advent, as we've heard a couple times now. And this is the season of waiting and watching. What are we waiting for? What are we watching for? We're waiting for the second coming of Jesus Christ. And that's what Christmas is about. We don't just celebrate the birth of Jesus, but we're waiting for the second coming of Jesus Christ. Christians continue to wait for Jesus to come back and make the world right. And we've been waiting for 2,000 years. And yet, even after 2,000 years, we're not discouraged. Why? Because the Holy Spirit gives us the gift of hope. That because God has been faithful in the past, God will be faithful in the future. And God is going to make this world right through the power of Jesus' love. Now, at Bethany Covenant Church, we teach our confirmation students, the Christian hope is the confident expectation of Christ's triumphant return when he will, any confirmation graduates here? Anyone? Anyone know this one? He will reign with his church forever, or reign forever with his church. I got it wrong, sorry. Oops. I got to go back to remedial confirmation. This is why I have to teach confirmation, so I could get all those catechisms down. The Apostle Paul, he puts it this way in the letter to the Romans, for in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not have, then we wait for it patiently. So Advent is the time before Christmas where we remember patiently that our hope in Jesus is secure because God has always been faithful, and we trust that God will always be faithful. Okay? That's hope. That's the Christian hope. In today's scripture from Jeremiah 29, we find the prophet writing to the first wave of Jews who were sent into Babylonian captivity, and these were the best people in society, the king, the queen, the best artisans, the best craftspeople. They were kidnapped, they were imprisoned, they were exiled in Babylon, okay? They're stolen from their home country. And these were the rich folk, and the rich folk were stolen away, and they were under house arrest in what is now called Iraq. And Jeremiah tells the captives, settle in. You're going to be in exile for a long time. They would be stuck in Babylon. They would be stuck in Iraq for another 70 years. In the meantime, they should build houses. They should plant gardens. They should get married. They should have babies. In other words, they should enjoy all the blessings of God. What's more, and this is the kicker, this is what makes Jeremiah 29 so radical and completely different from any other bit of ancient literature. Jeremiah, through the Holy Spirit, tells the exiles they should pray for their enemies and they should work for peace in a foreign land. Wild. Hear the good news, that God can redeem the worst situations in this world through the love of his son, Jesus Christ. Jeremiah 29, verse 1, and then 4 through 14. This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters into marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and the prosperity of the city to which I've carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it. Because of it prospers, you will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and the diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. And here's the scripture we've all heard before. Good to keep it in context, huh? For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. God's word. I was looking at social media the other day, and I saw a friend of mine who is a professional Christian speaker, and he had a mug that he was drinking some coffee out, and on the mug it says, I can do all things through God and scripture taken out of context. Those words about the Lord having a plan for us, let's put them into context this morning. It's going to be a little digging. I hope that's okay. I hope that the tryptophan has worn off from the turkey dinner and we can dig just a little deeper and I could talk a little bit about what that context is so we can understand how this relates to the Christian hope today, okay? Jeremiah wrote this letter in 598 BCE, and there were two kings of the Jews. Big brother Jehoiakim, he was kidnapped and under house arrest in Babylon, in Iraq, okay? And his little brother, Zedekiah, oh, little brothers, I'm a little brother. Any little brothers out there? Little brother Zedekiah, he's left behind in Jerusalem on to lead the country on behalf of the king of Babylon. And there's an intense sibling rivalry between the Jews in captivity and those who remained in Jerusalem. Anyone have family over for Thanksgiving? Don't raise your hand on this one. Just give me a little wink. Anyone see a little sibling rivalry this Thanksgiving? Give me a wink if you saw any of that this week. Oh, okay. That's what I needed to see. In this case, the future of the country was at stake. Who's going to rule? The fancy people in Jerusalem, or the rest of the people left, or the people in Babylon, the fancy people in Babylon, or the rest of the people left behind in Jerusalem? Okay, so apparently in Babylon, with all the rich and the powerful, there are some false prophets who are being encouraged, who are getting paid to lie in the name of God. They're giving the exiles false hope that God was going to rescue them any day now. And a violent insurrection took place in Babylon, and Nebuchadnezzar executed two Jewish militants, and some of the Jewish elders were also killed during the troubles. And behind this mutiny were these con artists who claimed that God is going to bring them home any day now. And this was just wishful thinking. It was not the hope of God. It was the wishful thinking of people who wanted a pony for their bedroom. They weren't dealing with reality. They were rebelling against a country they could not defeat militarily. The followers of King Jehoiakim were desperate to get back to Jerusalem because they wanted to be in control. Now, Jeremiah sent this morning's letter in King Zedekiah's messenger bag to communicate to the captives, God's not bringing them home anytime soon, okay? The captives would be sentenced to 70 years in Babylonian captivity. They might as well make the most of their time. Go ahead, build a house. Go ahead, plant a garden. Boy, imagine what you could do with a fruit tree in 70 years, right? Have kids. Have your kids have kids. Settle in. Make the most of your time. Don't deny yourself the many blessings of God. Enjoy life to the fullest, even when you're under house arrest. And we shouldn't be surprised that God is telling the captives to embrace life, even in a dark situation. Since the dawn of creation, God has invited people to enjoy abundance and fruitfulness and fertility and long life and peace and rest. That's shalom. This is what God promised Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And this is what Moses and the people of the Hebrews were seeking when they were wandering in the desert. This is what David built his kingdom on. That vision of shalom, the good life, okay? And the startling surprise in Jeremiah is that God commands the captives not just to seek shalom for themselves. God orders the Jewish people to seek the shalom and the welfare of the entire Babylonian Empire, their enemies, the people that kidnapped them. In all of ancient literature, there's nothing like this, what we find in Jeremiah, nothing like this. There are many other religions of that time that promised abundance and fertility and peace, but none of those faiths ever suggested doing a good thing for a rival, for neighbors, for your enemy. That doesn't exist, but it exists here. Just because Judah lost their homeland and their army and their temple and their king doesn't mean that they're powerless. Even in exile, they have the power to bless their neighbor and their enemy with the shalom of God. Now, the word that is translated as welfare in today's text is that word, the word shalom. And we know the word shalom, right? It means what? Well, it does mean peace. But it's much more than an American understanding of peace. It doesn't just mean the absence of violence. Shalom means that everything is precisely the way it's supposed to be. My favorite definition of shalom comes from Psalm 85:10. And I've told you this before, but I just love it. I'm just going to say it again. It's love and faithfulness will meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Isn't that nice? When righteousness and peace kiss each other, that's shalom. And that's what God has in mind for the Jewish people in order to transform Babylon, the kissing of righteousness and peace. And so Jeremiah, he writes, seek the shalom of the city where I have sent you in exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf. For in its shalom, you will find shalom. Jews were dying, rebelling against a king they could never defeat. And instead of fighting, God tells them, instead of fighting, work for love, work for faithfulness, work for righteousness, work for peace, work for shalom in Babylon. Now the Jews, they were commanded, pass on the blessings that God has given to you. Neighbors they didn't choose. Enemies they didn't like. That's who gets our peace. That's who gets our shalom. American Christians, we need to be careful with this text. There is a tendency that we sometimes have to develop a persecution complex and to over-identify with the persecuted people in the Bible. Unless you have lived a part of your life as a political or religious or economic refugee, I don't think it's fair to put yourself in the shoes of the Babylonian exile, okay? We need to be careful. You might feel like the world has changed in ways that are unfavorable to Christians or to you personally, but let's not over-identify with the Babylonian exile, okay? But there is a way that we could get connected to this text. By the way, there are so many Christians all over the world that are suffering like this, brothers and sisters in Christ who can identify with this. So let's not cheapen what's happening in their tough experiences with, you know, struggles that we find here in the U.S., okay? But there is a handhold. There's a way we could grab onto this text that still makes sense to us today. We need to look for the welfare, the shalom in our city. No matter how happy or unhappy we are with the politics of the day or what's going in our community, we can still seek out the shalom of the city that we live in, of the place where we are. Today, I want to give you two examples of the Christian hope that has blessed the welfare of Mount Vernon, Washington, and the Skagit Valley. These ministries were not idle wishes. These ministries are hopeful because they required vision and sacrifice and hard work and financial support. And God took these small gestures of faith, of hope, of love, and magnified them into something that was far bigger than what we could have ever done on our own, okay? It's an example of how the blessing of God has been taken by you and me and passed on to other people. And in doing so, we've brought glory to God. Hope, it's a gift from God that we get to participate in right here, right now. Now, many years ago, someone at Bethany Covenant Church volunteered with the Red Cross to provide emergency shelter when the Skagit River floods. I don't know who came up with such a hopeful idea to use this building as a place for flood refugees. Whoever it was, I am thankful that she or he saw the day when Bethany Covenant Church would be able to seek the shalom, the wholeness of Mount Vernon by providing a house for the displaced and the homeless. We had a strange week at Bethany Covenant Church 2 weeks ago when the flood hit. Looks like we might have another, doesn't it? We had a strange week. We opened up our building to people in need. And suddenly, we had to move meetings into unfamiliar rooms, and our kitchen was dedicated to feeding 3 hot meals a day to hungry people, and our gymnasium was lined with cots instead of children, and Bethany Preschool and our Children of the Valley after school program and the youth group and confirmation and women's Bible study, they were interrupted by the floodwaters in order to create space for neighbors in need who needed a dry place to sleep. Most of the time, this building is a blessing to us and our friends for the ministries we do. But during this flood, the building was repurposed to seek the shalom of the city. For in its shalom, we find shalom. I want to thank all the volunteers who showed up to serve our neighbors in need. And I want to thank everyone who had to sacrifice a Bible study room or a gathering of friends at church in order to create space for neighbors in need. But mostly, I want to thank God for the hope of this warm, dry building that we got to share with our neighbors in need and to bring glory to God that way. I thank God for this hope. We did a little bit of something, and God made it a lot bigger than our human efforts could have done on our own. That's hope. It starts in God. We get to help out a little bit, and it comes to full realization by the grace of God. The second example is a shower trailer for the homeless. Before the COVID-19 crisis, the deacons of Bethany Covenant Church invested some money with Skagit Connections to help build a shower trailer to serve the homeless in our community. And by the way, our flood shelter, it didn't just help people who were displaced by the flood. It helped a lot of homeless people in our community. Years ago, gave money to Skagit Connections to build this shower trailer with 4 separate shower units and with 4 volunteers, a truck driver, a cleaner, and 2 hosts. This shower trailer can serve homeless people throughout our community, right? It could drive anywhere, give people a clean shower, give them a chance to wash up a little bit. By the way, if you ever want to volunteer with this ministry sometime, talk to the deacons. They'll be happy to connect you with this very important ministry. Oh, and one more thing. There's also going to be like a brass concert at Bethany Covenant Church on December 3rd at 7 p.m. to help support this ministry. You might want to check that out. You like brass concerts? You like caring for the homeless? You like Bethany Covenant Church? Come. Listen to some good music. I hope you can make it. But during the flood, Skagit Connections brought the shower trailer to the Bethany Covenant Church parking lot to use it for the very first time. This is something that's been worked on for years. For the very first time, the displaced and the homeless people who were sleeping in our church gym were able to get clean. If you've ever slept in a car, or if you've ever slept on the streets for a few weeks or a month, you know what an incredible blessing a shower is. It means that the neighbors in need can confidently apply for a job, can confidently go and try to rent a room, something as simple as a shower changes lives and helps people get started once again. Now, those are two undeniable examples of how Christian hope, grace of God, involving our participation, realized in a way we never could have imagined, have increased the welfare, the shalom of Mount Vernon in our midst during this month. The person who volunteered Bethany Covenant Church as a flood shelter years ago had no idea that we were going to open up the church doors a week and a half ago, because they couldn't predict the weather. And yet their hope, their hopeful vision was realized in a powerful way that changed the lives of more than a dozen people. And the deacons had no idea that the first stop of the Skagit Connections shower trailer would be our very own parking lot. But because of their hopeful vision, they changed the lives of some of our new friends who are living in our building. Again, the words of the Apostle Paul. But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. My friends, Advent is the season of hopeful expectation, and we're waiting for the return of Jesus when the world is made right and people are not having to live on the street and people are not needing to get a shower from a trailer, okay? We're waiting for Jesus to make the world right. And in the meantime, that hope provokes us to receive the grace of God, to get involved in that grace of God, and to be surprised how that grace comes alive in wonderful ways. When we get invested in the purposes of God, pay attention to where the Holy Spirit is showing up and be a part of that. Oh, you will be blessed more than you will ever bless anyone else. This is the Christian hope. We know that Jesus is going to triumph over all the evil in the world. Don't you want to be a part of that today? There's only 1,000 or 1,000,000 ways to get involved in the purposes of God today. Go volunteer at Children of the Valley. Go help the shower trailer get to work. Go to a brass concert. Be part of God's hope in the world today. And just watch. Just watch God's grace breaking into the world. This is why we're not discouraged after 2,000 years of waiting for the return of Jesus Christ. Because today, that hope is being realized among us. Isn't that good news? It is good news indeed.
Thank you.
I think it's Hebrews 6:19 that says, we have this hope, this sure and steadfast anchor of the soul. And the image there is that Jesus is the anchor that clings us to the throne of God itself. And so since we're tethered by this love of Jesus, we get to act in the world today connected to the King, the kingdom of God that changes the world. My friends, let us be hopeful people. There's so many discouraging stories in the world, and there's so many sad faces behind masks. Can we be the hopeful people that bring glory to God by pointing out that God will redeem the sad stories of this world? And today, today, we get to be, in a small way, a part of the redemption of the world. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace and his hope. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.